In Hebrews chapter 12 and verses 5 to 9. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 5 to 9. Shall we pray? Our God and our Father, we want to honor you. We want to bless your holy name. This afternoon, we pray that mighty God, you are God. You alone, glorious King of Kings, grant us the authority to stand and speak and do that which you desire, O God, because you are God that says you've given us authority to trample over serpents and scorpions and over every power of the enemy. This afternoon, O God, we thank you for who you are. We bless your holy name. We pray that mighty God, you are God by yourself. In Jesus' name, oh God, we pray. Amen. Amen. Oh Lord, my God, when I'm in awesome wonder, oh, said I, oh, thou great thy hand has made. I say the stars, I hear the mighty thunder. Thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou, oh, how great thou art. You in the past few days that we've been meeting here, we've been praying, we've been sharing the word, and the man of God that shared before me ministered to my heart. I'm feeling so blessed, and I'm just imagining, Lord, this is what I desire, this is what I want. And he started with keeping the fire burning. I want to remind you, keeping the fire burning. How can we keep the fire burning? We can only keep the fire burning when we come in the presence of the Lord, when we worship Him, when we pray. Then we can start keeping the fire burning, and much more as we read the word of God. And then secondly, he talked about the foundations. On what foundation are you, man of God? On what foundation are you standing? On what foundation are you built on? And indeed, there are many foundations. Certain foundations are bad. They are horrible, shaking, depending on your ancestors, depending on where you come from. They are horrible, and they impact the surrounding. They disturb people. They shake others. They are very disturbing. But the foundation of Jesus, so powerful, so wonderful, beyond boundaries. And then he talked about the legacy. What legacy are you going to leave? What legacy are the people going to see when they look at you? What legacy is God, much more, going to see that my child of God did something? He went. And then I talked about kingdom living. Because when I looked at what like a man of God shared. I asked God, God, what next? And God says, kingdom living. In this kingdom, we need to recognize who we are. We need to know who we are in the kingdom of God. Because when you know, then you have a destiny. When you know, then you have a name. When you know, then God is God. He is God by himself. He changes not. The same yesterday, today, and forever. And that's why in the kingdom, he ministers. And when he ministers, healing, deliverance, salvation happens because he taught the kingdom of God. He spoke the kingdom of God. Nothing else. Wherever I went, he spoke the kingdom of God. And I remember saying on Friday, when that centurion saw this, he said, Master, he recognized the authority in Jesus and said, Master, just speak a word. Because he could see the King of Kings. He could see the King. And the same thing happened with us. And then I spoke about prayer. In the kingdom, kingdom living, desires that we pray, desires that we put on the authority, desires that we remove the clothes of death. Whatever bondage, whatever curse, when we pray, it begins to break. It begins to come out. It begins to go because we are praying. And the more you pray, the closer you get to God. The more you pray, the more you rub shoulders with God. And the more you pray, you become like an electric cooker connected to power. I can't imagine if anyone can touch an electric cooker when it is hot, connected to power. Nobody will touch it because it's hot. And that's the fire that we need. And I said, Lord, what next on Sunday? I was there. Pastor John, I said, Pastor John, I don't know what next on Sunday. Then Pastor John says, are you not praying? I said, I'm praying. But what next on Sunday? I went into prayer. I started praying. And I said, Lord, what is it that you want me to speak to your people on Sunday? And then I said, Lord, I think I want to speak about this breaking camp and advance. Then God says, no, not that. I said, then what do you want me to speak? What is it that you want me to talk about? Then, as I went to sleep, then God gave me a vision. I saw myself getting anointed. And I saw my son, my oldest son, not studying. And I was annoyed. Pain came into me. And I wanted to discipline my son. I said, does he know what it takes to study? Does he know what it takes to read these books? Does he know what it takes to move into daddy's car? Does he know what it takes every day to be taken to school? Every day to be given transport money? Does he know what it takes to live in this house? I got a whip. And I went 2 strokes. And when I went, I looked at him and said, come here. And he was charging at me. Annoyed as well. Daddy, but what do you want to do to me? I said, come here. You don't understand. Can you come here? Then I said, Lord, what is it that you want me to speak on? Then God told me, God's discipline. In the kingdom of God, there's discipline. In the kingdom of God, there are standards. verse 5. And have you entirely forgotten the encouraging words God spoke to you, his children? He said, my child, don't ignore it when the Lord disciplines you. And don't be discouraged when he corrects you. For the Lord disciplines those he loves, and he punishes those he accepts as his children. Nobody wants to be disciplined. Nobody likes discipline because it is painful. When I saw my son begin to rage at me, when I saw my son get annoyed, I remember how I used to feel when dad becomes annoyed. You know, teachers, they're disciplinarians. And my dad was a teacher. And he wanted to make sure I am the best. He wanted to make sure I do better. But literally, did I realize that he was trying to discipline me for the better? Literally, do we realize that when God disciplines us, he is doing it for the better, that we can be trained and become holy and enter into his kingdom and begin to experience kingdom living? And I want to speak about the four T's, even as I speak about discipline of God, the discipline of God that is good. And the first T that I want to talk about is the discipline of darkness. Many times, circumstances, situations become bad. Even when you're a child of God, circumstances just become bad. Even your best friend is not coming to say, hi, Pastor Peter. Your best friend begins to withdraw and go backwards when things are bad. You are going through a moment of darkness. A moment where it bends. A moment where you feel nobody stands with you. A moment where things are hectic. And sometimes you even begin to question God. And even the people that know you, they begin to say, where is his God? The discipline of darkness is painful. The discipline of darkness is hard. Even your wife stands away and begins to look at you. Remember, in Job, in the book of Job, the wife decides to ask Job to curse God. Why can't you just speak against God? Because when she saw what was happening to Job, she couldn't stand. Because when you look at in Job chapter 2, you will see that there's a scenario that begins to happen that God allows to happen to Job. And as they were seated, angels, everyone, all the people that are found in meetings when God has a meeting, they were there. And as they were there, then the devil was also there. And seated, and God noticed, there's somebody strange here. What about you? What are you doing? Where are you coming from? And he says, I'm coming from running, from wandering. Out there. And then they begin to have a conversation about Job. Then, okay, what about Job? Then he says, is it that he just worships you because you bless him? Because you do this and this to him? That's why he worships you. Then God allows a dark moment to happen to Job. Says, God, you go and try it and see if he's not my son. And Job goes, and the devil goes to Job, and as he goes, he begins to inflict pain, so much pain, everything, his animals, his children, everything begins to go. That's the moment of darkness. Things are hard. His friends trying to run away. Things are hard. This is a moment that Job, when he looks at this circumstance, he begins to say to himself, in Job 23 verses 10. He knows the way that I take. Because after he has tested me, then I shall come forth like God. Because God is not cheap to make. God desires that it goes into the furnace. And in a furnace it goes as gold dust. Then gold dust begins to burn, begins to be purified, and it comes out as gold. And that's the gold that we see. That's the gold that we wear. God desires to purify our lives. God desires to make us understand who God is. You know, even in these circumstances, if you look at Isaiah 45 and verses 7, let's just read that quickly. When you look at that verse, you will see that God says these words. 45 verse 4 up to verse 7, God speaks these words. Because sometimes when it's happening like this, you don't know what to do. You don't know where to go. But that's when he says, and why have I called you for this work? It is for the sake of Jacob, my servant, Israel, my chosen one. I called you by name when you did not know me. I am the Lord. There is no other God. I have prepared you even though you do not know me. So all the world from east to west will know there is no other God. I am the Lord. And there is no other. Verse 7. I am the one who creates light. I am the one who creates darkness. I am the one who sends good times and bad times. God does it all because he wants to change the character. He wants to transform us. He wants to change our circumstance. He wants us to realize that God is God. If only you and me can see God in such a circumstance, then he remains God. Hallelujah. If you can see that he is God in such a circumstance, then he remains God. Begin to think about that moment in your life. Maybe you've been trying to get married, but a man is not coming. That's a dark moment. Maybe you've been trying to see. You saw and saw, but it's not happening. That's a dark moment. Maybe the womb is barren and there is no child. It's a dark moment. It's a moment that if you can see God, maybe you had a funeral and none of the people came to visit you. And you decided, because they didn't even visit me, I'm not going to be going to church. And you've been lagging behind. I want to tell you, that's a moment of darkness. If only you can see God, then he's God by himself. Hallelujah. The second discipline that God uses is the discipline of delay. Many times, you and me want fast everything. Quick money. Quick everything. Huh? Quick girls. Quick men. Quick everything. Many times, we want quick things. Quick cell phones. Just because so-and-so has an iPhone, and so I should have an iPhone. Even if you don't have the money, you want an iPhone. Because so-and-so is driving a Dodge, so you also want a Dodge. And so you want to go and steal so that you can have a Dodge. But I came to tell you today that God uses the discipline of delay, because some of us, if he gives us those things, maybe we will even stop worshiping. Maybe we will stop coming to church. Maybe we will forget about God. But God uses the discipline of delay to change our character, to transform us, to show us that he is God. Amen. I don't know what is happening. God. He delayed this moment even for me to stand here. But I sat waiting upon the Lord because I know what He was dealing with me. Maybe I was in a moment of darkness. Maybe I needed to be delayed. It doesn't just happen, but He is God. Remember, in John chapter 11, God, Jesus, heard that Lazarus had died. But even when He heard, He delayed 2 more days. Begin to imagine, this is Mary and Martha, and Mary much more, she is the one that washed the feet of Jesus and anointed them with oil. Can you imagine anointing them with oil? But when Jesus heard, and then He delays. He never took a step, but decided to wait and delay the process. He delayed for 2 more days. Can you imagine how Mary was feeling? She thought Lazarus was the best friend to Jesus. She thought she was the best friend to Jesus. But Jesus is not showing up. Jesus is nowhere to be seen. He's not showing up. But then suddenly He comes on the scenery. And when He comes, do you know what Mary did? She recognized that this is the Lord. She recognized that this is Jesus. She began to run towards Jesus. She ran, but Master, if only You had been there, then Lazarus couldn't have died. But Jesus knew He needed to delay to show the glory of God. He needed to delay to show the greatness of God. He needed to delay so that they may know that there is God. Amen. And when He came, He showed up in the scenery. He showed up in John chapter 11 and verses 44, 43, somewhere there. When He showed up, He came and said, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus came. You know how He came? Bound. Can you imagine how He came? Bound. Lazarus, come forth. And it was coming, bound, legs, everything and the head, but He came out because He is God. I don't know your situation. I don't know your circumstance that is being delayed, but I want you to recognize that God is God. He changes not. He is mighty. The same yesterday, today, and forever. He is God. When you see His beauty, you even begin to sing, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He is God. Whether they are enemies, He sets the table. Even though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, there is God. He changes circumstances. He changes situations. He is God. No matter what people have said about you, I want to tell you, I want to prophesy this afternoon that God, if only you can see God, He will change your circumstance. He will change things. He will turn them around because He is God. That is His name. He spoke and things began to be. Just by a way, He spoke and things began to be. What more your situation? What more your circumstance? What more what you are going through? Hey, if only you can see God, an opportunity is coming at an opportune time. An opportunity is coming at the right time. On God's agenda and on God's time. The Bible says, in the fullness of time, He allowed Jesus to come on the scenery. Whoa! Yeah, 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 yeah! In the fullness of time, He changes circumstances. uses is the discipline of discouragement. Certain moments you want to go forward and things are not happening. In the moment that I prayed and sought God and asked Him to come here, I never knew that He would allow my dad to die. Because this moment when dad had an accident, I went into prayer. I fasted. I prayed for more than 1 month. But God told me, I need your dad. He called my dad, son, come. Can you imagine how I felt? I wanted God to be healed. And I wanted dad to be healed. And then he's not being healed. What a circumstance, Lord. Okay, quickly I realized, this is God. I need to look at him and say, Lord, thank you. You've taken him. After all, he is saved. He is with you. Thank you, Lord. Because this is an opportune time. Look at the Israelites. In the wilderness, they started suffering just a bit, just a small twist to just try and see how they can stand. And then they got discouraged. And then they went to Moses. Moses, why did you bring us here? Why didn't you just leave us in Egypt? After all, in Egypt, we had everything. We were eating. We had everything. They've forgotten that in Egypt, they just suffered. They were slaves. They didn't even have enough. They forgot that when they came in the wilderness, God even gave them just enough. Because He dropped manna. They forgot that to the promised land where they were going, it was a land of plenty, flowing with milk and honey. Many times when we are discouraged, we even end up doing certain stupid things. Things that nobody expects us to do. You even fall. And when people ask you, and they say, you see, excuses. When we are discouraged, we end up doing things that we don't expect to do. But I came to say to somebody that even if it is a thorn in the flesh, like in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7 to 8, where Paul was given a thorn in the flesh, he complained, he prayed 3 times, and God simply said, in your weaknesses, I am made strong. In your weaknesses, in my weaknesses, God makes us strong. God wants to transform us. He simply says, my grace is sufficient for you. Can you imagine how discouraged Paul felt when that word came to him? Can you imagine that circumstance? You've been praying and all you can receive is my grace is sufficient for you. In your weaknesses, I am made strong.
I am weak, but thou art strong.
Let's just sing that song.
I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus,
Okay. It's like me. It doesn't matter. You feel discouraged, but in this circumstance, if you can see God, if only we can focus on Him, then a breakthrough comes. And in verse 9, Paul says, so now I am glad to boast about my weakness, so that the power of Christ may work through me. He is so God in his circumstance. He saw God in his situation. He saw God in the things that he was moving it through. So it doesn't matter whether they call you names, whether you encounter calamities, whether something comes, if you can see God in that circumstance, then God remains God. You know, even this moment, discouraged because every time we are hearing, okay, let's build the house of God. Every time, every time when we go, let's build the house of God. Don't be discouraged. If only you can see God in this circumstance. Forget about others. I know some people are going through hectic situations, hectic moments. I know some people are going through situations that are making them discouraged, that are making them feel they are in a dark moment, that are making them feel delayed. But if only we can see God, then God changes the circumstance and situation. And finally, the discipline of disturbance. To discipline us at times. He does it in this way, like the way an eagle does. An eagle who have a nest up in a tree, the tallest tree, that's where an eagle will put a nest. And when the eggs hatch, the eagle begins to collect the food and take to the eaglets. The eagle goes to collect food and gives it to the eaglets. And the eaglets get used because they know that he brings food and gives to us. She brings food and gives to us. They relax. And because they've relaxed, one day the eagle comes without food in the mouth. And when it comes, the birds, the eaglets, they're opening their mouths. And then there's no food. Then the mother goes, swings through the nest and tries to go away. And then, but there's no food. Then again he comes, swings and swings through the nest. Then even some of them, those that are intelligent, they say, we have to follow where she's going. Where she goes to get food, that's where we need to go. They try and fly. And as they try to fly, then she says, okay, they've started flying. She goes and sits. And then the eaglet sits on the back, and then it comes and puts it back in the nest. The following day, it comes, and then it doesn't bring food. This time, it disturbs the nest. Just begin to disturb the nest. Shake it. Shake the nest. Shake the nest. And when it shakes the nest, then the bird, what is happening? Mom now is shaking the nest, and where do we go? They begin to then to fly. They begin to force themselves to fly because God just disturbs your circumstance, your situation, so that you can begin to learn to walk by yourself. That circumstance that has disturbed you is meant to encourage you, is meant to lift you. That circumstance that you feel is shaking your head, shaking your body, is meant to build your life. He was in the boat one day with the disciples. Whilst in the boat with the disciples, then a storm came. And then he decides to sleep. How can he do this? Because he's the one we trust in. Then they saw them. Hey, Peter, have you seen what has happened? Can you imagine a storm? When they saw this circumstance, they just realized that, after all, we are with Jesus. If only you can see Jesus, if only you can see God, then the circumstance changes. The situation changes. And not only there, finally, he told them that he was going in John 14 verse 1 for to prepare many rooms. You know, they were with this master. He's the one they saw as a master, as a king, as a defender, as everything. Now he's about to go. They just got disturbed, not knowing what he wanted them to do. He wanted them to stand. If only they can see God. If only you can see God in your circumstance, then God comes through. A breakthrough comes through. If only we can see that he is God. It doesn't matter what you are going through. Shall we just stand to our feet? Oh, Jesus. It doesn't matter what people have spoken about your life. It doesn't matter the situation, that moment of darkness which you are going through. But if only we can see God, circumstances begin to change. Then he becomes God by himself. It doesn't matter. Even if it is dark, even if the situation is hopeless, but I want to say that you can endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. If only you can see God in your circumstance, then God begins to change circumstances. He begins to release, he begins to deliver, he begins to heal, he begins to provide, he begins to do everything, because he is God. God that changes circumstances. God that is real. Put aside that discouragement. Put aside that disturbance. Put aside that moment of darkness. And a breakthrough will come. I want to speak life in that dark moment. I want you to speak life in that dark moment. I want you to speak life in that disturbance. I want you to speak life in that delay. I want you to look at God. Forget about your neighbor. Forget about who is next to you. But begin to look at God. If only you can see God. It's not about your husband. It's not about your wife. It's not about your brother. It's not about your sister, but it is you. These circumstances that happen, it's because God is looking at you. He's looking at you. He's looking inside you, in the body, in your mind, in your life. He's looking at you. He looks at individuals. He calls us one by one. He doesn't call us as a group. And that's why, even if we don't worship him, he is God. Can you imagine? Even if you don't worship, even if I don't worship, he is God by himself. He can raise storms to worship him. He is God that changes circumstances.
Open the floodgates of heaven, let it rain, let it rain.
I want us to sing that song, and as we sing that song, the power of God, I can sense the power of God will reign in this place. The power of God will begin to touch. It's not about me, it's about Jesus. If you can see God in your circumstance, then God begins to turn things around.